Hello dear students, welcome to the IIT PAL series of biology. I am Rikisha Bhaumik, PGT Biology at Kendriya Vidyalaya Sector 2 RK Puram, New Delhi. In today's session, I have brought for you a set of multiple choice questions from the topic ecology and environment. Ecology and environment is an important component of various competitive examinations, be it AIPMT or the civil services examination. Almost all the entrance examination of the state level and national level comprises of the questions from ecology and environment. Basically, this trend has emerged lately because of the rising importance of these topics on our lives. Ecology is that branch of biology which helps us in giving a holistic perspective about the things being happening in the nature or the environment. Just like the diversity in living organism, biology is also a diverse subject in itself, having so many branches like botany, zoology, microbiology, molecular biology and biochemistry, etc. But there are certain threads which link these different branches into a unifying principle. And ecology is one such unifying principle which gives us a holistic perspective, and it helps us in understanding the various concepts with an insight. So, let us begin with our question answer session. Question number 1. The term biodiversity is commonly used to describe the number, variety and variability of living organisms. What is the heritable variation within and between population of organisms called? Here, I would like you to recall the concepts which we learned in the chapter biodiversity. We have learnt about the various levels of biodiversity, if you remember, and there are three major levels of biodiversity: one at the genetic level, the other at the species level, and thirdly at the ecological level. So, the options are as given: species diversity, genetic diversity, ecosystem diversity, all of the above. So, what will be the correct answer? Yes, since the question is asking about the variety and variability of living organism, the diversity which is particularly related is the genetic diversity. So, let us recapitulate what points we should remember and recall while answering such question. Genetic diversity, which accounts for the difference in genes among individuals and species. Species diversity refers to the diversity among the species level within a particular region. Ecological diversity is the variation in ecosystem found in a region or over the whole planet. So, we are moving from the genetic to the species and to the ecological level. Moving on to the next question, which is again from biodiversity. The question is, biodiversity forms the basis for human existence in the following ways. Number 1, soil formation. Number 2, prevention of soil erosion. Number 3, recycling of waste. And number 4, pollination of crops. So, what is the question? Which one do you agree with? Biodiversity is essential for soil formation, because soil formation occurs by the process of weathering, and we know that there is an interaction of the biotic and abiotic factors which helps in breaking down the rocks and boulders and form the soil. Moreover, the litter and the dead matter also gradually form the humus and adds to the fertility of the soil. Secondly, prevention of soil erosion, we cannot agree more. The presence of plants, trees, grasses, the roots, they hold the soil together and helps in preventing soil erosion. The third one is recycling of waste. Recycling of waste, we know that there are certain microorganisms which not only helps in nutrient cycling, but it also helps in decomposition process. So, the third one is also correct with reference to the biodiversity, and the fourth one is pollination of crops. Pollination of crops is undertaken by the pollinators. Basically, there are two types of pollination: autogamy and xenogamy. Autogamy is self-pollination and xenogamy is the cross pollination. In plants where there is self pollination, although there is no need of pollinators, but for the cross pollination purposes, we need different groups of insects or birds, bats or animals which help in pollination. So, this is also basically a function or a feature of biodiversity. So, the answer will be that we agree with all of them. Biodiversity is essential for soil formation, prevention of soil erosion, recycling of waste and pollination of crops. Moving on to the next question. Which one of the following is not a site for in situ method of conservation of flora? Again, this question is also from biodiversity. We have learnt about the method of biodiversity conservation, where we classified the methods into two. One was in situ and the other was ex situ. So, here the question pertains to the in situ method of conservation. In situ means on the site method of preservation and protection of the organisms. So, what are the options? Number 1, biosphere reserve, B is botanical garden, C is national park and D is wildlife sanctuary. So, if you remember, can you answer this question? In situ method of conservation, I told you what are the different methods which comprises in situ. Biosphere reserve, yes. Botanical garden, no. It is a method of ex situ conservation. National park is yes, and wildlife sanctuary is also in situ method of conservation. So, the correct answer here will be botanical garden, which is not a site for in situ method of conservation of flora. So, what points should we remember? In situ conservation is the on the site conservation or the conservation of genetic resources in natural populations of plants or animal species. And the example, the basic examples which comprise them are biosphere reserves, national parks, wildlife sanctuaries and sacred groves. Next, the red data books published by the International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources IUCN contains list of number 1. Endemic plants and animal species present in the biodiversity hotspots. Number 2, threatened plant and animal species. Number 3, protected sites for conservation of nature and natural resources in various countries. So, we have described about the IUCN, International Union for Conservation of Nature, and we have seen that IUCN is the organization which is responsible for enlisting or maintaining a catalog of the threatened species, and the catalog is published by IUCN on a regular basis. So, what will be the correct answer? Yes, you are right. The correct answer is second, threatened plant and animal species. But here in the question, select the correct answer using the codes given below, 1 and 3, 2 only, 2 and 3, 3 only. So, in such question, you need to understand the question properly, you need to read the question properly, what actually the question is asking. At times it happens that we know the answer, but because we are not understanding the question properly, we end up giving wrong answers. So, it is better to read the question properly. But in these options, we know that IUCN only enlists the threatened plants and animal species. So, the correct option is B. 2 only. Moving on to the next question. 3 of the following criteria have contributed to the recognition of Western Ghats, Sri Lanka and Indo-Burma regions as hot spots of biodiversity. So, here the question is asking about hot spots of biodiversity. We have also discussed this, the hot spots. They are characterized by 3 important features, if you remember. So, let us see the question. These are enlisting various characteristics. Number 1, species richness. Number 2, vegetation density. Number 3 is endemism. Number 4 is ethnobotanical importance. Number 5 is threat perception. Number 6 is adaptation of flora and fauna to warm and humid conditions. So, if you remember the 3 important characteristics of hotspot biodiversity, hotspots, those were number 1, it should be rich in species. So, first one is correct. Secondly, it should have a lot many endemic species within it. So the third one appears to be correct, and the third feature was that it should be under enormous threat of extinction. So the fifth one appears to be correct. So here we can say safely that the options which we will take are number 1 species richness, number 3 endemism, and number 5 threat perception. These are the basic characteristics of biodiversity hotspots. Moving on next, resource conservation is an ancient practice that refers to the management of resources by humans. Many Indian indigenous communities have adopted traditional methods to conserve their natural resources, such as the formation of sacred grooves. In which Indian state is the sacred groove Iringol Kavu located? Again, the sacred groove, we have mentioned in the earlier question that it is a method of on the site conservation, in situ conservation, and sacred grooves are the stretches or the patches of forest tracts which are conserved and preserved by the local people because it is intricately linked with their culture and religion. So, India boasts of many such sacred grooves, and Iringol Kavu is also one. Let us see the options: Jharkhand, Kerala, Rajasthan, Maharashtra. So, you have to remember here that Iringol Kavu is located in Kerala. It is a famous Hindu temple which is dedicated to Goddess Durga, situated in Kunnathunad Taluk of Ernakulam district. It is 5 km from Perambur, which is in Kerala, and it is a sacred grove. So, let us move to the next question. A biosphere reserve conserves and preserves. Is this statement true for any or all of the categories mentioned? Wild animals, land, vegetation, all of the above. So again, if you recall, biosphere reserve, it was constructed under the Man and Biosphere program, and the concept behind biosphere reserve is to link man with nature. And I also made you understand this, the structure of biosphere reserve, with the help of 3 concentric circle. As you can see in this figure, that the core zone, buffer zone, and manipulation zone, 3 zones are present in a biosphere reserve. The core zone is basically for the protection of plants and animals. The buffer zone is for educational and research activities in order to find out solution for their preservation. And the manipulation zone has the local peoples residing within it. But these local people, they use the resources here, but they do not destroy them, and they live in harmony with nature. So we can safely say that all these 3 are protected under a biosphere reserve: wild animals, land, as well as vegetation. So the correct option will be D, all of the above. So what should you remember here? Under the program MAB, Man and Biosphere of UNESCO, the creation of biosphere reserve was initiated, which happened in the year 1975. A biosphere reserve is divided into 3 zones: core, buffer, and manipulation. Next, the effects of climate change are alleviated by forest that reduce the level of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The forest, we know that as the forest comprises basically of the trees which undergo the process of photosynthesis, and in this process of photosynthesis they consume carbon dioxide to reduce it into carbohydrates as food. So basically they are using the carbon dioxide, and oxygen is released as a byproduct in this process of photosynthesis. When forest thrive, atmospheric carbon dioxide is absorbed by forest in their woods, leaves, and soil. For this particular natural activity, forests are also known by which of the following terms? Number 1, carbon shakers, carbon sinks, carbon absorbers, or carbon fighters. Here the correct option will be B, carbon sinks. What is a carbon sink? A carbon sink is anything that absorbs more carbon than it releases as carbon dioxide. For example, European forests are currently a net carbon sink as they take in more carbon than they emit. In the climate negotiations, this temporary reduction of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is also known as negative emissions. We are much worried about the carbon emissions in the air in the form of pollutant, but these forests can actually help us in building negative emissions of carbon because they act as carbon sinks. Next question is, what are endemic species? In a previous question, we discussed about the biodiversity hotspot, where we mentioned that a biodiversity hotspot has three important features. Number one, it has species richness. Number two, it has many endemic species. And number three, it is under constant threat of extinction. So, what are endemic species? The options are A, critically endangered species, B, species having cosmopolitan distribution, species found only in a particular region, or the extinct species. The correct answer is C, species found only in a particular region. The endemic species are those which are confined to a particular region and they are found nowhere else. And so, they are also under threat or they are vulnerable to extinction, because if that particular region is destructed or destroyed, those endemic species will not survive. So, what you need to remember here is that endemism is the ecological state of a species being unique to a defined geographical location, such as an island, nation, or a country. Endemic species, for example, in western Ghat of India are lion-tailed macaw, Nilgiri langur, brown palm civet, and Nilgiri thar. So, these are the examples of the endemic species found in western Ghat of India. Next, moving on to our 10th question. Employed in the manufacture of solar cells, which is this element that is the second most abundant in the earth's crust after oxygen? So, the question is telling you one more fact, that oxygen is the most abundant element on the earth's crust. Which one is the second one? If you don't remember, there is an additional hint that it is used in the manufacturing of solar cells. Let us see the options: titanium, magnesium, silicon, aluminium. Probably you might have guessed the correct answer by now. Yes, it is silicon. Silicon is the second most abundant element on the earth's crust. It is used in the manufacture of solar cells or photovoltaic cells because it is a semiconductor. Next question. Marine biodiversity is facing a serious threat today due to falling pH levels of the oceans. This is one of the greatest challenges affecting marine life as it increases the level of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. What is the phenomenon called? A, eutrophication. The B option is ocean acidification. C, plastic waste contamination, and D, none of the above. So, here the correct option will be, because there is falling pH level, that is means acidification. So, the correct answer will be ocean acidification. But we need to remember something about it. What is ocean acidification? It is the ongoing decrease in the pH of the earth's oceans caused by the uptake of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. Sea water is basic in nature, slightly basic in nature, means the pH is more than 7, and the process in question is a shift towards pH neutral condition. When the pH is lowering down, it means that it is becoming neutral rather than acidic. So, the ocean acidification can be a misnomer in sense, but since there is a reduction in the level of pH, we will say that the process involved here is ocean acidification. And naturally, this process is detrimental to all the aquatic organisms because it will impact their osmotic balance. Next question. Chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs known popularly, they are the ozone depleting substances. They were used in the production of plastic foams, in the production of tubeless tires, in cleaning certain electronic components and as pressurizing agents in aerosol cans. Which of these statements given above are correct? These CFCs were widely used earlier before we came to know, before we understood that these are the substances which are responsible for ozone depletion. And these were rampantly used in plastic foams, in tubeless tires, it was used as refrigerants, it was used in cleaning electronic components and also as pressurizing agent in aerosol cans. So, all these options are correct and we will select the D option as the correct one, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Next, which among the following are the examples of secondary pollutants? Pollutants, what are pollutants? They are the contaminants. For example, if we talk about air pollutants, the air has a composition which comprises of nitrogen, oxygen, carbon dioxide, water vapor and other gases. If their concentration increases or if there is a substance which is other than what should be present in its composition, that is termed as a contaminant or pollutant. These pollutants can be divided into two types. Number one is primary pollutant and the other is the secondary pollutant. In this question, you have to identify the secondary pollutants. The options are A, smog, B, PAN, peroxyacetyl nitrate, C is ozone and D, all of the above. So, you should remember what we mean by primary pollutant and what we mean by secondary pollutant in this question. Primary air pollutants are those materials that when released pose health risk in the unmodified forms or those emitted directly from identifiable sources. So, these are those pollutants which are directly emitted from the identifiable sources. The secondary air pollutants are those primary pollutants which interact with one another, sunlight or natural gases to produce new harmful compounds. So, the sources are identifiable and the emissions which we can identify from those sources are the primary pollutants. For example, carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, sulfur oxide, nitrogen oxide, particulate matter, all these are the primary air pollutants. And the secondary air pollutants, the pollutants which are the primary pollutants which are already present in the air, when they combine with something like sunlight or water or natural gases and they form a new pollutant which is very harmful for the organism, that is known as secondary pollutant. And the examples include photochemical smog, peroxyacetyl nitrate, ozone, all of the above will be the correct answer. Coming to the next one, acid rain is caused by the pollution of environment by A option carbon dioxide and nitrogen, B carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide, C ozone and carbon dioxide and D is nitrous oxide and sulfur dioxide. So, basically what is acid rain? When we are talking about acid rain, actually the pollutants which are already present in the air, for example, the sulfur oxides or the carbon dioxide, let us take carbon dioxide, and when it rains, we have water H2O. So, when carbon dioxide and water reacts, it forms H2CO3, which is carbonic acid. A reaction takes place resulting in the formation of acid, and similar occurs with the sulfur oxides which results in the formation of sulfuric acid, nitrous oxide which reacts with water to form nitric acid, so again this acid rain can also be categorized under the secondary pollutant because the pollutants are already present in the air, and when they react with the precipitate or the water, it forms a new compound, carbonic acid or the respective acids. And these acids are very harmful for living organisms, especially the aquatic living organism, the lower organisms. And also we have also seen the impact of acid rain on the famous monument Taj Mahal. The marble is starting yellowing because of the impact of acid rain, because it degrades the calcium carbonate present in the marble. What will be the correct answer here? The correct answer will be nitrous oxide and sulfur dioxide. Acid rain is caused by emission of basically sulfur dioxides and nitrogen oxides, which react with the water molecules in the atmosphere to produce acids. Next question is biomagnification, and it is asking the cause of biomagnification. Biomagnification is mainly caused by hydrocarbons, organochlorines, organophosphates, or none of the above. So, we first need to know what we mean by biomagnification. There are actually two terms associated with this kind of principle. One is bioaccumulation and the other is biomagnification, and these are associated with the trophic levels in the food chain. Bioaccumulation is the accumulation of certain toxic substance at a particular trophic level of the food chain, whereas biomagnification is the successive increase in that particular toxic chemical or compound with the increasing trophic levels. As there is a food chain and there are trophic levels which are linked together, the compound which is showing this kind of tendency to accumulate as well as increase with the respective trophic level, and this phenomenon is known as biomagnification. And it is basically seen with the organochlorines. So, what will you remember in this question? Biomagnification, also known as bioamplification or biological magnification, is the increasing concentration of a substance such as a toxic chemical in the tissues of organisms at successively higher levels in a food chain. Organochlorines like DDT, PCBs, polychlorinated biphenyls, cyanide, selenium and other heavy metals, they have been found to cause biomagnification. So, the correct answer here will be B, organochlorines. Next question, a pond with high value of BOD is highly polluted, highly productive, highly clean, none of these. Again, BOD is biochemical oxygen demand. Biochemical oxygen demand. Oxygen demand. And it is written as BOD, commonly the short form is used BOD. So, what is BOD? BOD is actually an indicator for water pollution. It is an indicator for water pollution. But we need to know what is the meaning of BOD. What is BOD? BOD, biochemical oxygen demand, is actually the amount of oxygen which would be consumed by the aerobic microorganisms or decomposer to consume all the organic matter which is present in 1 liter of the water to oxidize it. So, biochemical oxygen demand is the amount of oxygen required by these decomposers to oxidize the organic matter present in 1 liter of water. The organic matter is an indicator of the pollutant. The sewage is organic in nature. If there is more organic matter, the oxygen demand will be more. So, if there is more oxygen demand, there will be more BOD. So, we can say that more is BOD, more polluted is the water body. And one more thing which we need to remember here is that BOD shows an inverse relationship with dissolved oxygen content, because the water has dissolved oxygen which is utilized by these organisms for oxidizing the organic matter. But if the dissolved oxygen content is less because of the accumulation of more organic matter, then more oxygen will be required, and this is known as BOD. More is the BOD, less is the dissolved oxygen content. So, what option will you select here? A pond with high value of BOD is A, highly polluted. Next question is, algal bloom results in. You must have seen the ponds covered with a scum of algae throughout. This is known as algal bloom, and it results in acidification, saltation, eutrophication or biomagnification. What will be the correct answer? Algal bloom is associated with eutrophication. Eutrophication is basically the cultural aging of, is the natural aging of the lakes. Eutrophication refers to the aging of lakes with time. We know that there is a succession, and the lakes or water bodies gradually over a period of time will turn into land. But it has been seen that due to some human activities, there has been tremendous growth in the algae in the water bodies, which is leading to acceleration of this natural process of eutrophication. And this is also known as cultural eutrophication. It occurs when excessive fertilizers run into lakes and rivers. We have been using fertilizers, pesticides and chemicals. These fertilizers, they flow with the water and they enter into the water bodies, and when they do so, the algae, they get immense nutrition to grow at a very high rate. So, this encourages the growth of algae and the other aquatic plants as well. Following this, the lake or the water body faces overcrowding, and there is a competition for the sunlight, space and oxygen. Eventually, when these organisms will die, they will need to be oxidized by the bacteria, they will need to be decomposed, and that will require oxygen which will be consumed. So, a condition like hypoxia will be created in the lake. There will be a loss of oxygen from the water body, resulting into the killing of aquatic life totally. I hope this question was quite clear. Next, moving on to the 18th question. Under the provisions of the Forest Conservation Act, prior approval of the central government is essential for diversion of forest land for any non-forestry purposes. The basic objective of the Act is to regulate the indiscriminate diversion of forest land. In which year did this Act come into force? 1980, 1988, 1970 or 1960? So, there has been a Conservation Act for forest by the Indian government, and this mandates a particular proportion or percentage of land to be covered by forest, and the diversion of that forest land for any other purpose is to be regulated with the help of this Act. This Act was given in 1980, it was enacted in 1980, and further amendments were made in 1988. It was enacted to help conserve the country's forest. It strictly restricts and regulates the de-reservation of forest or use of forest land for non-forest purposes without the prior approval of central government. This also gives us the guideline that there should be 33% land area covered by forest, but unfortunately, we have only 21% of our land presently as forest. Next question. The most frequently quoted definition of sustainable development is: sustainable development is development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Which of the following reports highlights and promotes this definition? I have also told you earlier that there has been many conventions, and the terminologies which we see today is a result of those convention. One such important convention or report was the Brundtland report, which gave us this term sustainable development. So, obviously, I have told you the answer in this question. The correct answer is Brundtland report. There has been other options also, Basel document, Cartagena protocol, Aarhus convention, but the one associated with sustainable development or the concept of sustainable development is the Brundtland report. It was an enlightening report given by the Brundtland commission, and the title of this report was Our Common Future. It was released in October 1987, and this document actually coined this term sustainable development. Next question. There are a large number of global agreements and conventions with an agenda to protect wildlife. Which of the following agreements specifically targets the conservation of migratory species of wild animals? A. Bonn Convention, B. Ramsar Convention, C. Cartagena Protocol, and D. is Vienna Convention. Again, this is a factual question pertaining to the knowledge or awareness of the environmental issues and the steps being taken. So, you need to remember them. Let us understand them, what they were: the Bonn Convention, Convention on Migratory Species, Ramsar Convention. This has been discussed in my previous session. It was an international treaty for the conservation of wetlands. Cartagena Protocol was a global protocol to ensure safe transfer, handling and use of living modified organisms arising out of biotechnology. And the Vienna Convention is for the protection of ozone layer. So, the correct answer here is A, Bonn Convention, which targets the conservation of migratory species of wild animals. Moving on to the next question, question number 21. Here you have to pick up the correct food chain. You must remember here that a food chain comprises of producer, followed by a primary consumer, secondary consumer, and then the tertiary consumer. So, the first option is grass, chameleon, insect, followed by bird. But we know that there is some error here. Insect should be eating grass, followed by chameleon. B option, grass is eaten by fox, fox is eaten by a rabbit, and then bird. Again, there is some error here because there should be rabbit and then fox. The C one is phytoplankton, followed by zooplankton, and then the fish. This appears to be correct. This is actually correct. Phytoplanktons present in the ocean, they are eaten by the zooplankton, followed by the fish. And the last one is fallen leaf, followed by bacteria, followed by insect larvae. This is actually showing the detritus food chain, fallen leaf, but it should be followed by insect larvae, and then the bacteria should come into play. So, the correct answer is C, phytoplankton, followed by zooplankton, followed by fish. Point to remember here is that you should know what is a food chain. The transfer of food energy from the producer through a series of organisms, herbivores to carnivores, then top carnivores or decomposers, with repeated eating and being eaten, is known as food chain. In nature, basically two types of food chain are recognized. One is the grazing food chain, which always starts with the producer and it has the herbivore, carnivore and top carnivore, and the other one is the detritus food chain, which again will start with the dead matter, be it the leaves or the animals, followed by the detritivores, which will feed on them, followed by the decomposers, and it will help in nutrient cycling and all. Moving on to the next question. Energy flows in ecology refer to the flow of energy in a food chain. In which direction do energy flow operate in an ecosystem? First is unidirectional, B bidirectional, and C is multidirectional, D is none of the above. Again, if you remember that energy flow in ecology, what is the source of energy? The source of energy is the sun all the energy we are getting is the sun. Sun is the ultimate source of energy for all the living organisms present on earth. And this sunlight or the sun's energy is being transferred into chemical energy of food by the process of photosynthesis, which occurs in green plants. So, the energy flow will always be unidirectional. The correct option here will be yes, it is A, unidirectional. So, you have to remember this, that energy flows through ecosystem in one direction, typically from the sun through photosynthetic organisms including green plants and algae to herbivores to carnivores and decomposers. Next question, what is the process by which one natural community changes into another over a time scale of several years to centuries called? The options are A, progression, B, succession, C, reproduction, and D, none of the above. We see that in an ecosystem, there is a succession of community, there is a subsequent succession of the communities. The first one which invades a land first are the pioneer species. But there are certain serial stages in between until there is a stable stage which is known as the climax community. And this series or this subsequent series is known as succession. So, the correct option is B, succession. You have to remember, ecological succession is the gradual process by which ecosystem change and develop over time. Nothing remains the same and habitats are constantly changing. There are two main types of succession, the primary and the secondary. Primary and secondary, again the primary succession is the one which take place where there was no living organism present already. And the secondary one is that where there were some life present, but it was harmed, it was destroyed and again a new succession arose from it. So, these are the basic two types of succession, primary and secondary. Next question number 24, an ecosystem consists of both biotic and abiotic components, biotic the living organisms and abiotic the physical components. Which of the following comprises the biotic components? A is producers, B consumers, C decomposers and D all of the above. I think this is a very easy question. Producers, consumers, decomposers all are the living components and all will comprise the biotic component. So, the correct option will be D, all of the above. An ecosystem consists of biotic component, the living organism, abiotic component which are the non-living or the physical factors like light, temperature, water, nutrients, topography, etc. Evolution by natural selection is driven by these ecological interaction between the biotic and the abiotic as well as among themselves. Question number 25. Which of the following term is used for the total sum of ecosystem found on the planet? So, we have learnt about diversity, we have learnt the three levels, species, genetic and ecological, and we also know about ecosystem. Ecosystem is a functional place where there is an interaction between the biotic and the abiotic components, and there are so many ecosystem. Ecosystem can be very small and ecosystem can be very large. A pond is an ecosystem, there are man-made ecosystem like aquarium, and the sum total of all the ecosystem, what will it be called? The option here is lithosphere, atmosphere, hydrosphere and biosphere. The correct option will be, yes, you are right, it is biosphere. Biosphere is the global sum of all the ecosystem. It is actually a narrow zone of life which is connected by the lithosphere, atmosphere, hydrosphere, all are present in that particular zone. This is known as biosphere. It can be referred to as a closed self-regulating zone of life. Moving on to the next question, pyramid of number in a grassland ecosystem is? So, there are various ecological pyramids which we make, Eltonian pyramids, which are the graphical representation showing the trophic levels in a food chain. These are of three types: pyramid of number, pyramid of biomass, and pyramid of energy. So, this question is asking about the pyramid of number in a grassland ecosystem. Always inverted, always upright, both A and B, or spindle shaped. You can have some idea with the help of this pyramid. You can see that in a grassland there are grasses, which are the producers, which are large in number, followed by the herbivores, which are the primary consumers, followed by the primary carnivores, which are the secondary consumer, and very few secondary carnivores or the tertiary consumer. And this kind of pyramid is known as upright pyramid. So, the pyramid of number in a grassland ecosystem is always upright. Pyramid of energy will always be upright, because we know that sun is the ultimate source of energy. The maximum energy will be taken by producer. Then there is the 10% law which states that only 10% of the energy will be passed on to the next trophic level. So, there will be reduction in the energy as we move on to the next trophic levels. So, the pyramid of energy is always upright. Pyramid of biomass and pyramid of number, however, can be upright or inverted in certain cases. And the spindle shape is when that the middle portion is wider than the initial one and the final one. It is known as spindle shape. So, depending upon the situation, they can be of different types. Next question. Ecosystems have the ability to maintain normal patterns of nutrient cycling and biomass even after being subjected to ecological disturbance. What is this phenomenon known as? A. Ecological resilience. B. Ecological footprint. C. Ecological diversity. Or D. None of the above. The ability to maintain normal pattern of nutrient cycling and biomass, that means to withstand adverse condition, and the commonly used term for it is resilience. And when it is being connoted in reference to ecosystem, it will be ecological resilience. So, the correct answer is A. Ecological resilience is defined as the amount of disturbance that an ecosystem could withstand without changing self-organized processes and structures. And whereas, on the other hand, what is an ecological footprint? It is a measure of the human impact on the earth's ecosystem. How the human is impacting the earth ecosystem, his footprints, by the, this is basically measured by the carbon emission which takes place in the air. Next, a food chain comprises a number of trophic levels. Which is the trophic level most vulnerable to extinction? We know the trophic levels in a food chain. These are the producer level, primary consumer level, secondary consumer level, and the tertiary consumer level. So, which one do you think will be the most vulnerable? Yes, obviously, the one which are showing the least number, and in most of the cases we see that there are more producers as compared to the primary consumers, followed by the secondary consumer and tertiary consumer, which are lesser and lesser in number. So, what will be the correct answer? The tertiary consumer level. For instance, if we see a forest, in a forest there will be only one tiger, one or two tigers, and so because their number is less in the forest, it will be the tertiary consumer level and it will be under the most threat of extinction. So, we need to remember here that although every species has their own importance to the functionality of an ecosystem, some species are more vulnerable to extinction than others. And what are those species? Number one, those which are at the top of food chains, such as large carnivores. Number two, endemic local species. I told you earlier that endemic species are also vulnerable because they have a very limited distribution. Third, species with chronically small population. The species which are having very small population, again they are vulnerable. And the next one is the migratory species, which migrate from one place to another. And if that particular migratory habit gets destroyed, the species will not get the required resources and it might pose a threat to them. Next question. What is the full range of habitat type known as wherein a species can exist and reproduce without any competition from other species? The options here are A. Fundamental niche, B. Fundamental existence, C. Fundamental growth, and D. None of the above. The term niche I explained you in the earlier session that actually niche is characterized by a place where the organism not only lives but also establishes itself. It has a role and function in that particular habit. So, the full range of habitat type where the species can exist, reproduce and does not face competition from other species is A, fundamental niche. The full range of habitat type in which a species can exist and reproduce without any competition from other species is called a fundamental niche. Moving on to the next question. Every year, 5th June is observed as A, World Wildlife Day, B, World Forest Day, C, World Environment Day, and D, Biodiversity Conservation Day. Again, these are factual questions, but since they are pertaining to ecology and ecology is an important component of the various competitive exams, so you need to remember these facts. So, let us try to remember them. World Wildlife Day is on 3rd March, World Forest Day 21st March, World Environment Day is celebrated on 5th June, and Biodiversity Conservation Day is celebrated on 22nd May. And all these day has been formed by the UN regulation, United Nations regulation. Next question. What are organisms that live at the bottom of oceans known as? Again, ocean is also an important ecosystem, and in ocean there are various layers depending on the sunlight which falls on it. The options here are benthic organism, pelagic organism, periphyton organism, or none of the above. So, here if you know what are the various layers of the oceans known as, you can simply answer it. The ocean has the uppermost layer which is in direct exposure to the sun, that is known as epipelagic region, followed by the mesopelagic, and the lowest one which is deep is the benthos region. So, the organisms which live at the bottom of ocean is the benthic organism, coming from the name benthos, the layer benthos. So, benthic organism, the answer will be A. Organisms that live in and on the bottom of the ocean floors are known as benthos or benthic organism. And such organisms are worms, clams, crabs, lobsters, sponges, etc. Below the benthic region, below the benthos, there will be the abyssal region, which is the lowermost region and supposedly deprived of any life. Next question. In 1750, more than 350 people from the Bishnoi community in Rajasthan, India, sacrificed their lives trying to protect a particular tree species. Which is this tree? Khejri, Riwanja, Rohida, Kanjo. The Bishnois, a Vaishnavite sect living in western Rajasthan on the fringe of the Thar desert, have for centuries been conserving the flora and fauna to the extent of sacrificing their lives to protect the environment. You must be knowing about the Amrita Devi Bishnoi Award for Conservation of Wildlife. It has been constituted in recognition of their immense faith, immense sacrifice towards conservation and preservation of nature. So, the tree name is Khejri, answer is A. It is a acacia plant. Next question. To increase the spread of forest, trees are planted in areas where there were none. What is this process called? Your options are afforestation, agroforestation, deforestation, and reforestation. Reforestation, building forest again, deforestation, removal of forest or cutting of forest, agroforestation, which is linked with the agriculture, and afforestation is actually your correct answer. these are the, this is the process where the trees are planted where the trees, where no trees were present earlier. Moving on to the next question, exponential growth occurs when there is A, no environmental resistance, limited resources present, a fixed carrying capacity, great environmental resistance. So, here we are talking about exponential growth. The exponential growth curve actually comes out to be a J-shaped curve. There is exponential growth if we plot the graph between population density with respect to time. And this exponential growth will occur when there are, when there is, which will be the correct option? When there is no environmental resistance and there is abundance of natural resources present in the nature. So, when the resources are unlimited, population exhibit an exponential growth resulting in a J-shaped curve. When the resources are limited, population exhibit logistic growth. So, this is the exponential growth curve. And the logistic growth curve, which is somewhat realistic, comes out to be a S-shaped curve. This is the S-shaped curve, which comes out to be in the case of logistic growth curve. Here you can see that there is a lag phase, there is a gradual increase followed by acceleration or deceleration phase, and this is the asymptote phase when it has reached its carrying capacity, which is denoted by K. K is the carrying capacity, the amount of resources which is present in that particular habitat which can sustain the organisms living in it is the carrying capacity. So, the last question is, the carrying capacity of a population is determined by A, natality, B, mortality, C, growth rate, and D, limiting resources. What will be the correct answer? I hope you will be able to answer it. The carrying capacity of a population is determined by the limiting resources present in that particular habitat. So, you have to remember the carrying capacity of a biological species in an environment is the maximum population size of the species that the environment can sustain indefinitely given the food, habitat, water and other necessities available in the environment. With this, I hope this session was good enough for you because we discussed so many topics with the help of the MCQs, multiple choice questions, and these are a general feature of many of the competitive exams. Moreover, ecology helps you in understanding many things. It gives you a holistic perspective of everything, of how the organisms interact, how they live in the nature, and how a imbalance in ecology or ecological imbalance will lead to detrimental, will lead to adverse effect on us. With this, I hope you enjoyed this lecture. Thank you and have a nice day.